I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, from the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love lifted even me, when nothing else can help. Love lifted me, love lifted even me, love lifted even me, when nothing else could help. Love lifted me.
Grace and peace to you from God, our Creator, and the Lord Jesus Christ. Good morning and welcome to online worship with Orange Beach Presbyterian Church. My name is Kim, I'm the pastor here, and what a joy it is that we are gathered together for worship today. A couple of quick announcements for you before we begin. The first is just the reminder that Thanksgiving is just around the corner. We are still accepting donations for our food pantry Thanksgiving dinners. We always accept donations for our food pantry. That's a year-round thing. But we are making an extra push, seeking some extra help for those Thanksgiving meals. We're going to buy turkeys, and we're going to put together a box with the turkeys and all the fixings, stuffing, potatoes, some packets for gravy, those kinds of things. So if you would like to donate toward that, if you have grocery items to bring in, you can bring those in anytime. There is a collection box right outside the back door of our church where you can always leave non-perishable goods. If you'd like to make a financial donation, you can also do that. Please just earmark it, food pantry, or turkey donation, either one, so that we know how to allocate that money. The next announcement is that we are participating in the Christian Service Center's Angel Tree again. Many of you did that in years past. You know, it's just you'll get a paper angel. You can choose one, and it has, if it's a boy or a girl, the child's age, and the request that they are making. So if you would like an angel or two, and you're not going to be here in Orange Beach to actually come pick it up, please just let me know. I'd be happy to kind of show y'all. I can take a picture of the angels. You can choose the one you want, or I can choose one for you and send you a picture of that. And you can either bring it in during the week when you have purchased the gift, or if you're one of our winter visitors and you want to make a financial donation and one of us can do the shopping, that's fine too. Just let us know. Nancy's going to be in charge of all that, and she will be picking up those angels and getting that ready. So just think about that if that's something you want to participate in. Even if you're not here in the church or here in Orange Beach, we would still love to have you share in that joy. And now, those are the announcements. It is time to begin worship. As always, we start with our call to worship, and all the words that you'll need today will appear on your screen as you need them. God gathers us together and summons us to worship. We will praise God in singing and in listening, in praying and in learning. God will send us out when we are done to share the joy we find here and the love that God gives us. Let us worship God together.
One.
Thank you.
into a time of confession. First, we'll pray silently, and then we'll pray together in the prayer found on your screen. Let us pray. And let us pray together. Gracious God, we get bogged down in hypotheticals, worrying about what might happen, instead of focusing on the present and trusting in you. Forgive us when we spend too much time on the details and not enough time on the bigger picture, bringing the good news to your kingdom. Take away our needless worry and help us to be fully present to the people and the situations around us. Guide us to action whenever we're needed. Help us to trust you more and more, so that more and more we can reach beyond ourselves with the love of Jesus. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. May the God of mercy, who forgives us all our sins, strengthens us in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Before we hear God's written word, let's turn to God in prayer. Gracious God, how we thank you for this day, for this time right now, gathered together with our siblings in Christ, worshiping you, praising you, singing hymns to you, hearing your word, recognizing your voice, all of us bound together with ties that cannot be broken. For we are bound together by your love for us and our love for you. Lord, we pray today that you will fill us with your Holy Spirit, that you will open our ears to hear, our hearts to love, our minds to know and understand and question and share. So fill us with your Holy Spirit, Lord, as we hear your written word. We pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, as together we pray how he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our scripture lesson today is from the book of Luke, chapter 20, verses 27 through 38. Some of the Sadducees, who say there is no resurrection, came to Jesus with a question. Teacher, they said, Moses wrote for us that if a man's brother dies and leaves a wife but no children, the man must marry the widow and have children for his brother. Now there were seven brothers. The first one married a woman and died childless. The second and then the third married her. And in the same way, the seven died, leaving no children. Finally, the woman died too. Now then, at the resurrection, whose wife will she be, since the seven were married to her? Jesus replied, "The people of this age marry and are given in marriage. But those who are considered worthy of taking part in that age and in the resurrection from the dead will neither marry nor be given in marriage. And they can no longer die, for they are like the angels. They are God's children, since they are children of the resurrection. But in the account of the bush, even Moses showed that the dead rise, for he calls the Lord the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob. He is not the God of the dead, but of the living, for to him all are alive. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Doesn't love a good hypothetical question, am I right? Who among us hasn't sat and pondered what happens after we die? What happens in the resurrection? What is beyond our earthly lives? What will it be like? And the big question, who will we see there? The Sadducees are asking this question not because they're theological giants just pondering what the afterlife holds. The Sadducees do not believe that there is a resurrection. So they come to Jesus with a question. You know, maybe they're trying to trick him. Maybe they're trying to prove to him that there is no resurrection. Maybe they're just pointing out the with all of these complexities, how can there be some joyous resurrection? Because things get complicated here. And they give him this example of the woman who was married to 7 different brothers, one after another, leaving no children. And the question is, well, when they all die, the last brother dies, the wife dies, whose wife is she in the resurrection? That's not a bad question. I mean, we might wonder that ourselves. When people have been married multiple times, I mean, I think it's normal to wonder. You always imagine when you die, you see the saints that went on before you. You imagine seeing your parents in heaven or the loved ones who went on before you. But if you have multiple spouses in your life, whose spouse are you in the resurrection? Now, in this particular example, there's 7 options here because the custom at the time when marriage was a lot more transactional, less on the romantic side and more on the transactional side, keeping the family name alive, that kind of tradition. And so if a man and a woman were married and had no children and the man died, his brother, again, by social tradition, would step in and marry the woman and hopefully have children to carry on the family name. In this particular example, it wasn't just a man and his brother, it was a man and six brothers. Seven men total, no children. And then after the woman dies, whose wife is she at the resurrection? I think of Gene Wilder. Do you remember Gene Wilder? He was married to Gilda Radner and way back, and they were, you know, famous actors, and she was on Saturday Night Live, and she died so young of cancer, and he was so heartbroken. And when Gene Wilder died, so many people said, ah, now he is with Gilda Radner. He's been reunited with the love of his life. And what a romantic thing, and what a hopeful thing that there is life after death, that there is an eternal life where we will see the people who have gone before us. But there's just, here's a question though. Gene Wilder got remarried and was with his second wife for decades. And the second wife was with him through his illness and held his hand when he had dementia and took care of him and loved him. And he loved her very deeply. So when everybody was saying, oh, he's reunited with his true love, Gilda, There were a few people who were saying, but wait a minute. So he had two really wonderful, amazing women that he loved deeply and was married to. Who does he see in heaven? Whose husband is he in heaven? I don't have an answer to that. Like most hypotheticals, there are probably multiple answers and guesses, and we don't really know for sure. Because we won't know until we get there. And once we're there, we can't tell anybody back here. So what does Jesus say when we have these hypothetical questions? First, I want to point out what he doesn't say. He doesn't say, how dare you ask? How dare you question? Why are you even thinking about such things? He has an answer, and he doesn't scold them for questioning. So take that as encouragement to ask questions. That's how we learn. That's how we grow. That's how we share our knowledge, is by asking and answering questions. Ask questions of Scripture. Ask your pastor questions. Ask your Christian friends questions. Ask God questions. If you've got questions, and hopefully we all do, what's that hymn say? Take it to the Lord in prayer. Ask God and listen for the answer, because clearly God doesn't mind some questions. If we are, especially if we are really truly exploring and not just giving hypotheticals in an attempt to prove that Jesus must be wrong. So here's Jesus's answer. Like the people of this age marry. But in the resurrection, the dead will neither marry nor be given in marriage, and they can no longer die. They're God's children, since they are children of the resurrection. He's not the God of the dead, but of the living, for to him all are alive. I love that. He's not the God of the dead, but the God of the living, because to God, all are alive. Jesus here is saying, these are earthly worries. This hypothetical question that you have, that matters to you here, but it's not gonna matter in the resurrection. It's not going to matter in the grand scheme of things. And when you think about it, the Sadducees are really asking, how can resurrection even be possible? Like, it's almost illogical. So Jesus moves on to answering their implied question. He talks about the nature of our relationship to God, right? Because to God, we're always alive. And if we're always alive, then what is death? If we have a resurrected life, death is not the end. That is a beautiful and wonderful and hopeful knowledge of how God sees us, of how our life here on earth is not the final say. It's the death has no sting that we often hear at funerals, which in the Presbyterian Church, we don't call them funerals, we call them a witness to the resurrection. And I love that. When you gather together to mourn and to grieve and to say goodbye to a loved one, I love that we call it witness to the resurrection. Because really, we know that we're not just saying goodbye. We know that we gather as Christians to proclaim the saving death of our Lord Jesus Christ. We will be reminded again in just a few minutes when we celebrate Holy Communion that death does not have the final say, that Christ is the victor. Because really, every day after the resurrection, every day is an Easter day. Every day we proclaim that empty tomb, every day we know that Christ is alive. So if we're getting it wrong about death, if we get it backward by thinking of death as an ending, what if death is just another beginning? What if death is just a transition into a different part of your life? And we're gonna have to sort of convince our brains to think about life differently. We always consider life to be bodily, right? Our bodies are alive and our bodies are dead. There's a certain way to measure a body, to see if it is alive or dead. You check for a pulse, you check for brain activity, you check to see if the body is still working. But what if we remember that bodily life and eternal life are just different parts of our one eternal life? What if death has no sting because it's just the body? Like I said, it's a good thought. It's a hopeful thought. And it's a thought that sort of has to remain just a little bit abstract because, like I said, we won't really know until we get there. The Sadducees ask Jesus a question that revolves around human relationships, but earthly relationships. Who is married to whom? But Jesus's answers revolve around God. He explains how we humans are related to God and how God is related to us. And he talks about Moses at the burning bush, calling God the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And this is not just the recitation of the lineage, the name of the dead relatives who went before it. It's not that God was their God in the past, only when they walked the earth. It's more than that. God is still their God because they are still alive to God. God is still actively in relationship with them. This is the message Jesus gave the Sadducees about resurrection, that our relationship with God will never be broken. And that's also kind of hard, it's a hard concept to get because all relationships are broken at some point. Earthly relationships, right? I used to tell my kids when they were young and they had just started dating, and sometimes when you're newly dating, things seem very serious. And I said, well, you know, all relationships go one of two ways. Either they end or you get married, you know? So, take some of the pressure off. Like, don't worry about the relationship ending. Just see where it goes. But that's the truth, is on earth, all relationships come to an end at some point. Sometimes we grow apart. Sometimes we break up. Sometimes we fight and get mad at each other and don't talk to one another anymore. Sometimes we recognize flaws in the relationship that make it toxic to one or both people in that relationship. And so it's a choice. We choose to end it. Sometimes relationships are wonderful and rich and full and only end at the bodily death of one or both. But the relationship that we have with God is not like that. There is not an ending to it. And it can ebb and flow, and we can feel stronger in our relationship in some seasons of our lives, and perhaps maybe feel like we've drifted away a little bit in other seasons of our lives. It can have that sort of up and down. But God is God, and God never gives up on us. God never ends a relationship with us. We are always alive to God. God is not concerned with the complexities of if you had two spouses, or if you broke up with your boyfriend here, would you ever have a relationship with that person in the resurrection? Again, these are all hypotheticals that we like to think about because our minds are sort of constricted to our earthly knowledge. But what Jesus is sharing is beyond earthly knowledge. What Jesus is sharing is the knowledge of God, who never, never ends that relationship. It does change, right? It changes from the now, the present, the bodily, to the resurrection, to the life eternal, to the church triumphant, we sometimes call it. And yeah, I've got questions, and I've yet to hear an answer, and I'm satisfied with that. That's okay. I know I'll wait, and I can be patient. Sometimes I wonder, you know, we get a new body, right? When the resurrection comes, you get a new body. What's that body gonna look like? Like, when I get to heaven, is it in this body? Can I have my 20-year-old body? Do I get a whole new one? Is it really a body like it's a body on earth? I spent a lot of time thinking about this, and I can hear Jesus just kindly laughing because, again, these are earthly concerns. These are bodily concerns. These are the concerns of the flesh. They're not the concerns of God, not the concerns of eternal life. They're really not important in the grand scheme of things. Because I wonder, when I see my grandmother in heaven, will she be the grandmother that I recognize with her white hair? Will she be a younger version of herself? And again, I think the answer to that question lies in here. Earthly worries, bodily worries, don't worry about that. And, you know, Jesus doesn't get mad that we question. It is good to learn and grow, but let's put things into perspective. And let's say, okay, honestly, when I get to heaven, I don't think I'm going to care what a body looks like. I don't think I'm going to care. I think I'm finally going to be able to release all of the earthly concerns and see what's important as I look into the face of Christ. So let's try to do that now. Let's not be like the Sadducees and try to come up with hypotheticals to disprove this or that. Let's focus on the here and now, knowing that what happens later will happen later, but what's happening right now? How can we bring a piece of God's kingdom to earth now? How can we enjoy the relationships that we have now? How can we make them better? How can we enrich them? How can we be active participants in good, loving, kind relationships, friendships, romantic relationships, work relationships? How can we bring a glimpse of God into all of our relationships? How can we stop thinking about these minor things and start focusing on what's really important? How can we remember that we are all siblings in Christ? We may have to be intentional about that until it starts to come more naturally. But let's not ever forget that we are God's children, that we are all co-heirs with Christ. So maybe not worrying about the hypotheticals and focusing on the real life right now, what's important, so that we as Christians can help bring the kingdom just a little bit closer. Amen. And let us now pray for and with one another. God of grace, God of mercy, how we thank you for all of the blessings that we have. We thank you for the glimpses of you we catch in creation, whether it's waves crashing on the beach or stars sprinkled across the sky at night, a beautiful sunrise, a beautiful sunset, birds flying in the air. All of these things remind us of the wonderful artistry of your works. We have such joy in our lives. We smile so frequently, and every time we smile, you are smiling with us. We thank you that you have the kind of relationship where we can run to you to celebrate and share all good things, to lift up prayers of thanksgiving for all that you do and are doing and will continue to do in our lives. But Lord, we are so thankful that you walk with us both in the ups and in the downs, that you recognize our joys and you recognize our sorrows, because there's a lot of sorrow out there too. We are all worried or grieving or sad or frightened. We are wondering what the future holds. We are trying to be grounded in the present, but it's kind of difficult these days. So Lord, we pray for all of those people who are sick, in mind or in body or in spirit. We pray for broken relationships, because although they are earthly relationships, they still wound and hurt and are needed. And we pray that you will fix what can be fixed and that you will help us let go of what cannot be fixed to move on to better things. We pray for our future. In this country especially, the election is just a few days away. And there has been violence and ugliness and hope and fear and so many emotions. So guide us through it. Speak into our hearts as we vote. And then speak into our hearts in the days leading up to it, and especially the days after, that we might continue to love and respect one another, that we might continue to be in relationships with one another where we can have conversations, we can ask questions, we can learn, and we can grow, and we can do everything to glorify you. We pray all of this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. We gather at the table from near and far, separated by distance, but united in Christ. And indeed, this is Christ's table. This table doesn't belong to the church. This is the Lord's table. And your tables in your homes right now, they've ceased to be your tables. Those too are tables of the Lord. And all belong here. All are welcome to feast, to taste and see that the Lord is good. When it is time to serve, if there are other people in your household, serve one another. As you serve the bread, you'll say, "This is the bread of life." As you serve the juice, the wine, the water, you'll say, "This is the cup of salvation." We will all eat at the same time, eat together, and we will all drink together. And now, let us begin with a word of prayer. Gracious God, how we thank you for these gifts, the bread of life and the cup of salvation. And we ask that you pour your Holy Spirit out upon these gifts, that we might be joined together as we remember your Son. We hold on to our family. We hold on to our faith community. And we share in this meal together. Lord, we pray for your Holy Spirit to do her work. We pray for this meal that we are about to join together to eat. And we pray it in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. On the night of his arrest, Jesus sat with his disciples. They sat at table, and he took the bread, and he blessed it, and he broke it, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. As often as you eat this, remember me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, and he poured it, saying, "This is a new covenant, written in my blood, shed for the forgiveness of sins. And as often as you drink this, remember me." And indeed, as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the saving death of our Lord Jesus Christ until he comes again. My friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Take your bread. Take and eat. This is the bread of life. And the cup. This is the cup of salvation. Drink and remember. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for this meal. It may seem like a tiny morsel, but it is like the widow's gift. It is just a small part, but with huge meaning, life-changing meaning. We thank you that this taste of bread, this sip from the cup, is a meal that we share with you in remembrance of you and for your glory. We are thankful, and we pray that this meal will nourish us, will fill us up so much that we are overflowing with your love, that it might be visible to the world around us. We pray this in the name of your Son. Amen. This concludes our worship service. Thank you so much for joining us. We'll be back again next week. But for now, we are going to turn off our phones and computers. We're going to be out and about in the world, thinking hopefully not of hypotheticals and of future things, which may or may not happen, but grounded in the present, ready today to show the world that God loves them. Be excited as we part ways. Turn this worship service inside out to spread the love of God to all that you see. And be excited as we do this, for as we part ways, we go with God the Creator, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, now and always. Amen.
Children of the Lord said,
Amen. Amen.